Hi, everyone. This is our last talk before lunch. Today we have Alyona. I pronounced your last name, so I won't. She holds a PhD from the University of Waikato in Natural Language Processing and Machine Learning. She's currently running Entopics, a software development and research consultancy. And she's also organizing the monthly meetups for natural language processing in New Zealand, which is really cool. And today she's here to talk to us about understanding human language with Python. Alyona?
Hello. So yes, today we'll be talking about understanding human language, or in other words, natural language processing. And I'd like to start with a story of how I got into this field. This was back in Ukraine. I'm originally from Crimea, and I was always good with languages, so I decided to become a linguist, studying German and English. I was in the lecture and surrounded by hundreds of women. This is a typical thing to do. And the professor for mathematics, we did the applied mathematics for linguists, said, and then there's this field called natural language processing where you use computers to do automated translation. And I was thinking, well, why are we doing all of this? If computers will be doing this in 20, 30 years, we're going to be all out of jobs. So I decided to switch and started studying NLP and haven't regretted ever since. I did my master's in Germany and then a PhD at Waikato, and about 5 years ago I joined Pingar, a company in Auckland, and last year I started my own company offering consulting in NLP. So today I will talk a little bit about the state of this field. You know, how good is it actually these days compared to what we expect from it? Then I'll talk about the complexity. Why is it so difficult to write algorithms that understand human language? And talk about how Python can help with this. And how talk about two examples of NLP applications built using Python. So let's start with fiction. This is Kit from Knight Rider, or David Hasselhoff's car, and he was talking to his car in human language, and the car was always quite humorous to him. And what's the alternative in the reality these days? Well, earlier this year I was at Google I/O, and Android Auto has been presented. So very soon, every car probably will have this kind of interface where you can ask computer for directions and opening hours and so on using the Google Voice API. And the person at the conference actually demoed it, and it did work. Another example from fiction, the Babelfish, those who have read Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy might have remember this creature that you stick into your face, must be slippery. But anyway, it makes you understand human language. The closest thing these days, I think, is the Wordlands app. You can get it on your phone and it works offline, which is great when you're traveling. You hover it over a short piece of text and it translates what you see into a different language. I actually used it last month at a party, and the person who was watching it said, "Whoa, this is magic." Well, check out this magic.
We are here to show you how easy it is to speak a new language by ordering Indian food in Hindi.
You've got this all tabbed up?
Yep, it's all tabbed up.
Okay. Dialing.
नमस्कार मैं अपने घर के लिए भोजन व्यवस्था चाहते हैं
अच्छा
मैं दो बासमती चावल चाहता हूँ
अच्छा
दो मछली करी बहुत गर्म और मसालेदार तीन आलू के समोसे मेरा पता है 138 मिल्टन
आपको खाने के लिए और कुछ चाहिए?
मेरा पता है 130 मिल्टन.
हाँ वो मैंने लिख लिया 138 मिल्टन.
Thank you and goodbye.
धन्यवाद. अलविदा.
No, I think it's gonna work. I think it's gonna work.
Okay. It's not gonna work.
It's gonna work.
So we just wait?
Okay. We wait. Dun, dun, dun.
Okay.
Hi. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Let's see how we did. We got 2 basmati rice, 3 samosas,
yes.
2 fish curry.
Here we go.
What do you think?
Extra spicy. Slam!
Uh-huh. Let's eat. Yeah.
So it does work. Another example from fiction is the Star Trek movies where you interact with the library computer. And again, Google here the answer in the reality. I just want to try this out again live. What is the weather today in Wellington?
Today's forecast for Wellington is 12 degrees with rain.
Not bad. And finally, relationships in love. This is this year's movie, and this guy decides to have a relationship with an operating system. Her name is Samantha, she speaks like Scarlett Johansson and is the perfect girlfriend. And in the reality we have this guy Joshua who decides to do the same thing with Siri. Unfortunately it doesn't go as well. So why is understanding human language so complex, even though we do have algorithms that are pretty good already? Well, it's because language consists of so many layers of linguistics, linguistic layers of meaning. So we have the speech sounds if we deal with a voice, and then the phonemes that have some particular meaning, and then we have the words. We need to identify what the words are and their components. Then we have the syntax, which is putting words into sentences, semantics, which is what each word and the sentence as a whole means, and then pragmatics, the meaning in context. And whenever you're developing a system, you can't just focus on one particular layer, they interplay with each other. So for example, when you develop an algorithm for detecting words in a spoken language, you kind of need to understand the context of what has been said before, and even actually who is speaking and in what kind of area. So if we just take the relatively simple task of segmenting sentences into words, you might think that in English it should be quite easy, you just split it white spaces. Well, not all languages have white spaces. For example, in Chinese, this is one sentence, and there are multiple words here, and they're not segmented. So before you start, you need to develop quite a complex algorithm doing word segmentation. And to be honest, English is also not as trivial as if we were to split this sentence into words. We would do silly things like splitting hot and dogs, and then we would have words that actually don't mean what they are supposed to mean if they're kept together, like hot dogs. Or it wouldn't be a good idea to split Coney Island. Then there are the semantic complexities, and it's an area called disambiguation, where you're trying to disambiguate the meaning of a particular word. So just looking at something like can, it could mean the tin can or the verb can. But if we deal with something like planes, where it's definitely a noun, there could be different alternatives. Is it the airplane or the geometrical plane or the plane the tool? And this is where algorithms typically again, look at the context, and if they know what the word flying means, they can then infer that probably this is the airplane. But then there is the ambiguity on sentence level. So flying planes can be dangerous. Is it flying a plane that's dangerous, or flying planes, the objects, are dangerous? And this is where even us, humans, would have a difficult time if there is no context. It could go either way. So developing an NLP system is quite difficult, but luckily there are plenty of tools, and plenty of tools in Python. And what I like about Python is that it's such a great language to deal with language, and there are already building blocks, and you can get started very quickly. You don't need to worry about many of these small problems. So I'm going to give you some examples. If you do deal with audio, there is the Pocket Smith library or the Google Voice API that you can use with Python. But once you have text, basically, these are the kind of things you can do already. You can extract keywords or text. You can categorize text into different categories. You can extract names of people, organization, locations, or biochemical entities, or any other domain-specific entities. You can determine the mood of the person who is writing the text, or in other words, sentiment. And you can determine the genre as well. So the first toolkit, the first tool for this kind of analysis that can help with all of this is called NLTK, or Natural Language Toolkit. It's basically a platform and also a great tool to learn natural language processing. It comes with the book, and it also comes with this UI that helps you to get started, because whenever you do natural language processing, you need to fall back on different resources, annotated corpora or document collections, or specific models built using machine learning. And with this UI, you can easily just go and download it from one central location, and then you can basically start programming straight away. A typical task in NLP at the very start is to get to the core words. So if we have these two texts, the first one and the second one pretty much mean the same, but the difference between them are those words in blue. And these are the words that we can interchange without the meaning, without altering the meaning significantly. And these are called stop words. And to get to the core words, what we can basically do is filter them out. And this is how you do it in Python. You import the stop words, and then you initialize the English stop words. Then once you have your words, you just, in one command, can filter them out. Easy. The next task is part of speech tagging. And this is where I go back to our example of flying planes can be dangerous. How do we know that can is a verb or a noun? And there are algorithms that are called part of speech taggers, and they can actually predict the tag of the word. In Python, we simply apply the POS tag command and on tokenized sentence, and this will tell you that flying is a verb, planes is a noun in plural, and can is a modal verb, and B is a verb, and so on, and dangerous is an adjective. So the algorithm basically looks at the context of the word, and something that is followed by the verb B is very likely to be a modal verb. So we know that this is not a tin can in this case. Another common technique is scoring words in order that in terms of their importance for a particular document. And this is where TF-IDF is used, has been used for years. It's like the magic formula. It basically combines the relative frequency of a term or a word in a document with the inverse proportion of documents that contain that term. an OTK does not have this functionality, but a different Python library called GenSim does. So here is an example of a code for computing TF-IDF. So you import all the libraries, and what I do next is actually reading one of the one of the document collections called movie reviews from an OTK, or you can use any document collection that you would like to analyze. And then it's just these three lines in GenSim. You're building the dictionary and building another object called corpus, and then you create the TF-IDF model. And what can you do with this? Well, if you have words like film, movie, comedy, violence, and Julie appearing in one text, you need to rank them. How important are these, for example, for a movie review? And the IDF value, or inverse document frequency, is something you can pull out from the GenSim TF-IDF object, and then you can have the values for film, movie, comedy, violence, and Julie, and you can see that film and movie are actually not that important. So you can, as you're ranking your words, you can use the statistics to discard them and rank the other ones like violence and Julie higher. Another example is text categorization. This is a very common technique in NLP, and you can apply it to so many different tasks. You can categorize news articles, for example, into politics, entertainment, sports, business, and so on. You can categorize your email into spam or not spam, or you can identify the author of the document. Was it really the Shakespeare, or is it a fake Shakespeare text? And the way it works is you basically convert your document into a vector containing of words. And for each word, you can insert the TF-IDF value. Then you can represent your documents in the multi-dimensional vector space. And as an example, if you have a collective vector for all the news articles on entertainment, and on the other hand, all the articles about politics, you compare. If you need to categorize a new document, for example, this TVNZ article, news article, you can just compute the angle between the vectors, and this will give you the similarity. So in Python, it's you don't have to develop any of this. You just use a library again, in this case, NLTK. Here is an example of how you create a classifier and how you classify a new document. Finally, sentiment analysis. Here I used a different library called TextBlob, and I pulled out from IMDb some reviews for a recent movie called Transcendence. I pulled out some 1-star, 5-star, 8-star, and 10-star reviews and tested the library, how well can it actually determine the sentiment. And they call it polarity in this case, and I printed out here the polarity values. And you can see that they actually correlate really well with how people have scored their review. So now, how do we put all these things together? At the tutorial that I was giving on Friday, we have, in just 3 hours, created a keyword extraction algorithm for movie reviews that come with NLTK. And this is an example for a movie review for Four Rooms, and the keywords that were extracted automatically from this review. For this particular movie, it looks quite good. For others, maybe it wasn't as perfect. But what we were after is actually getting some insights from movie reviews. There were in total 1,000 positive and 1,000 negative reviews. And we wanted to do some sort of data science. How can we, given this data and given the NLP techniques, find out what makes a successful movie? So we extracted the words and phrases, ranked them using TF-IDF, and then calculated what are the most common keywords in the positive and the most common keywords and the negative reviews. Can you guess which column corresponds to the positive and which one corresponds to the negative reviews? Which one, what column is this one?
Negative.
I think somebody in the tutorial said Star Wars must be positive, and they were right. Another application is analyzing beer reviews. So this is something I borrowed from somebody else's presentation, a guy called Ben Fjord. So he's into beer, and he said it's his nightmare to see all these bottles in a shop or in a bar and having to choose one. Ideally, he would like a very clearly defined drink menu, and they're not always available. However, what's available are beer reviews on sites like Rate My Beer or something. And there are so many reviews for each beer. So he developed a system to condense it. So what he did is, again, using NLTK to extract words from each review. And then he ranked them using TF-IDF. And he got something like this for a particular beer. And then he noticed that coffee, espresso, black, dark, they're kind of similar words, and he wanted to pull them out into more kind of, he wanted to cluster similar words together, and he used another technique called LDA that comes with GenSim library. And as a result, he had this kind of description for each given beer. So these are just two examples, and it's such a fascinating field. But what's coming next is even more fascinating. This is kind of where we want to get, and this is what researchers at universities are working on. So when we have a sentence like, or part of a sentence like, Jack Ruby who killed JFK's assassin Lee Harvey Oswald, something, 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 what we would like from the computer is to not just understand what are the strings and which ones are the important ones, but actually what they mean and what does the sentence as a whole means as well. So this is where you algorithms rely on knowledge bases. And in this particular example, two different knowledge bases are used. One is called Freebase, which is basically taking Wikipedia and making it structured and machine readable. And what happened here is, first the algorithm extracted entities, named entities, for each of the people mentioned in this fragment, and then they disambiguated them, so identified exactly the concept that stands for that particular string, or the three people with the unique IDs underneath in Freebase. Then they have applied the dependency parsing, which identifies what is the action that was performed, and in this case it was killed, and then who was the subject performing the action, and who was the object. And then they also linked the action to another knowledge base called VerbNet, which basically encodes what each verb or an action means, like killed an assassin. So what we have is basically a string of natural language completely decoded and readable in a way that machine can understand. And this is the kind of analysis that IBM Watson has performed as well. For those of you who haven't heard of IBM Watson, this is an AI system or question answering system that was competing at the Jeopardy, a quiz show in the US, and the researcher has tweaked it so well that it actually beat two of the experts in this game. So these are not just random people, these are people who do Jeopardy the best, and the computer has beat them. And I think this is amazing, and is such a great confirmation of where we are in this field. Whereas there is also people who are quite critical, like John McCarthy, saying that, well, we can't really say whether or not computer understands language because we don't understand how this language understanding works in human hands. And to my mind, you can be in either camp. You can be all negative or you can be all positive and keep developing new stuff and keep coming up with new solutions to problems. I would like to finish this talk with a story. I was very lucky to attend an unconference in the US called Full Camp, and I was very brave to decide to run a session on NLP, and I called it NLP, Are We There Yet? And I was just out of uni for a year, and what I wanted is to talk to other people who have companies and actually find out from them, are NLP algorithms good enough to be used in commercial grade applications? And so you just have the title NLP, Are We There Yet? And I was sitting in the room, and 10 minutes before the session starts, this guy comes in. And I know from the introductions that he's the head of security at the Burning Man Festival. And I was just looking at him and thinking, what is he doing in this session? So I asked him, are you interested in natural language processing? He goes, oh, I thought it's neuro-linguistic programming. I said, no, it's the other NLP, but it's also very interesting. And he said, no, I was just tossing up between the two sessions, so I'm going to go into the other one. So he left. And I was terrified. What have I done? I should have been more explicit like I did in the talk for this title, for this talk. And the next person comes in and said, it's natural language processing, right? And I'm like, yes. So it was a really good discussion with people who I admire personally. I was starstruck when Andrew Ng came in, who is the director of the Stanford AI Lab. And it was basically a discussion of are the algorithms good enough? And the conclusion was that yes, they are, particularly the data-driven algorithm, like the ones used in Google, and particularly the ones that use machine learning and techniques like deep learning. And today we talked about NLTK, GenSim. GenSim is one of those both have these kinds of algorithms integrated. And if you would like to find out more, also check out the scikit-learn, the machine learning library, and the Ciano, which is the deep learning library and framework. If you want to, if you didn't get a chance to attend the tutorial, but you would like to play around with some code, there's a GitHub repository. And if you just want to stay updated, you can follow me on Twitter or follow this hashtag NLProg. So not NLP, but NLProg, just to differentiate this field from the other one. Thank you. Maybe one or two.
Okay. So we have time for one or two questions, if anyone has one. One, two.
Hi, that was a really interesting talk. It occurs to me that although the technology is obviously getting better, is the problem getting harder? Because I'm really old, and when I was at school, we were taught to spell and do grammar and use apostrophes and things, and these days people don't bother with that stuff anymore. Does it make it harder?
I think it's actually getting easier because more and more data is available in digital form, and the more data we have, the more we can infer statistically. For dealing with text speak and the kind of language that's used in tweets, people just develop special components. I know this company in Auckland that has a text speak to English speak translator. So you just deal with it.
Following on from that a bit, it was in the news last month or maybe the month before that various US government agencies are interested in contracts to get to detect sarcasm in Twitter and Facebook and so on. Do you think we're a long way off from being able to realistically identify what is actually sarcastic speech and what is genuinely a threat?
I think it's an interesting problem, and I think it depends on the situation. There is actually a paper that you can look up. It's developing an algorithm that can automatically attach "that's what she said," "that's what he said" to any sentence. So there are plenty of PhD students that love this kind of thing, and they're happy to spend 3 years studying how to detect sarcasm. So I don't think I don't think we're too far.
That's all the time we have for questions. Lunch should be being served outside. Thank you very much.